Good morning and welcome to our worship service. Thank you for watching. Thanks to everyone who's participating in the service this morning. At the end of the week, the last Sunday of January would be our annual meeting. The council voted to postpone the annual meeting given the pandemic. But I hope tomorrow in the daily email that you'll receive a copy of the annual report and a short video presentation on the 2020-2021 proposed budget. And if you have any questions at all, please feel free to ask. And now let's enter a spirit of worship. Thank you, AJ and Carolyn. And now join me in a word of prayer. Wherever we find ourselves on this cold morning, we are grateful to have set this time aside. Some of us have had peaceful mornings, others mornings filled with stress. May we take a moment to catch our breath, to slow down, to see the good in ourselves, others, and our world. May all that is done and said this day be in service to love and justice. We pray this even as we remember the prayer that Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now join me in a great hymn of faith, immortal, invisible, God only wise. Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Hebrew Bible, the book of Jonah. I'll provide a little summary since the assigned reading this morning begins at the end of the story. Jonah is a prophet in Israel. The Lord commands Jonah to go to Nineveh and preach a short, simple message: repent, or the Lord would destroy the nation. Now, to make a contemporary analogy, Nineveh is Washington, D.C., the capital of the most powerful nation in the world. And Israel, a small, insignificant country, constantly defeated and troubled by Nineveh, Assyria. So naturally, Jonah doesn't want to go to Nineveh. His mission is really laughable. First, who is he to demand the mighty nation repent? And truth is, he doesn't really want them to repent. He doesn't want God to love his enemy. So he gets on a ship that's headed to Tarshish. That's probably toward Spain, but he's supposed to be going the other way toward Assyria. He flees in the opposite direction. A great storm happens. Eventually, the sailors determine what has happened because Jonah has sinned. And so Jonah says, throw me overboard. And reluctantly, the sailors do that. And then, you know, he's swallowed by that big fish. Spends 3 days in the belly, and then is vomited out. And then he heads reluctantly to preach in Nineveh. That's where we pick up the story. Chapter 4. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you. So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city going a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. The people of Nineveh believed the prophet. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil deeds, God changed his mind about the calamity that he said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. Meanwhile, Jonah sat sulking in the shade of a plant. Here ends the reading.
Good morning, everyone. I hope you're all doing well and staying warm during this cold day. I wanted to start by asking a question. How many of you out there have ever been angry at someone? Maybe for those of you that have brothers and sisters, have you ever gotten angry at your brother or sister? How about your parents? Have you ever been mad at your parents? I can envision my kids right now sitting at home going, yep, yep. How about your friends? Have you ever been angry, or have your friends ever done anything that made you angry or mad before? You know, if you've answered yes to these questions, you're not alone. Because we all get angry from time to time. Here's another question. Have you ever been angry at God? Is it right to be angry with God? Should I even be asking that question? It's a tough question, I think, but I do know that anger can sometimes come from misunderstandings. And there are some times when people don't understand or question what God is doing or not doing. And that can certainly turn to anger. You know, the Bible has several stories of people who were angry with God. Michael just read part of a story of a man that was angry with God. His name was Jonah, and it's a fascinating story, this relationship between God and Jonah. And in the story, there's a couple times where Jonah is mad at God. In the first chapter, though, however, when he's mad at God, he does something I think we can all relate to. He got mad, and then he distanced himself. He actually ran away. When we get mad at each other, that's the easy thing to do, I think. We create distance. We accept our anger, and we create distance from that person. Now, in chapter 4, in the story that Reverend Michael just read, we find Jonah mad once again. But in this story, Jonah does something a little different. Instead of distancing himself, Jonah actually leans in and talks with God. Perhaps to get a better understanding of what God is doing or why God is doing it, but maybe communicating to ease his anger. Maybe we can do that. When we get mad at someone, when someone does something that makes us angry, the easy thing to do is to distance ourselves from them. But if we lean closer and communicate with that person, maybe get a better understanding of what happened or why that happened, hopefully we can get closer to ending that anger. Have a wonderful week today.
Raise my hand so you child who's held throughout a storm. You keep me warm in your arms of love. Storms will come and storms will go. I wonder just how many storms it takes until I finally know you're here always, even when my skies are far from gray. I can stay, teach me to stay.
Thank you, Cindy and Carolyn. That was beautiful. And then once again, I'd ask you, as we spend a moment in prayer, to continue to keep Jane McAllister as she continues to struggle with her breathing and anxiety issues. And then as we have the past few weeks, I'd encourage you to take a time this morning to ask, what can I do? What can we do to turn down the temperature in our country? So let us be in a spirit of prayer. In the stillness and quiet of this moment, we acknowledge that sometimes we don't know what we should pray or how we should pray. Sometimes we simply hold silence and seek to sense your holy presence. Each of us watching knows someone who is sick, someone hurting, someone who is dying, someone who has just died. Someone who suffers from mental health issues, someone who suffers from self-destruction, someone who needs healing and wholeness. May they feel our presence in new ways. May they experience healing and comfort and deep, deep love. May we do what we can to offer them a sense of peace and wholeness. In a world so consumed by hatred and violence, by mistrust and prejudice, ignorance, help us to look for ways to live together in peace. In a world of hunger and poverty, help us to be good stewards of the resources entrusted to our care. And then may we have eyes that not only see pain and suffering, but all the opportunities present for love, healing, and restoration. And may we find ourselves somewhere between hope and despair, and then help us to discover the power of love. This is our prayer. Amen. I was so excited, but I didn't know what to do next. We'd gone up north with some friends of my father. One of his friends had a nice cabin on a lake in northern Michigan. And so I got up early Saturday morning, fished from the dock. I think I was about 7 years old. I loved fishing. But whenever I had fished before, Mom and Dad were always there by my side. On this particular morning, I was alone on the dock. And when the bobber was yanked down, I gave the line a quick jerk. And I knew the hook was lodged securely in the fish's mouth. And as I reeled it in, I could tell this was the big one. And when I pulled it out, I was elated. The biggest fish I'd ever caught. It must have been about that big. But then I didn't know what to do. You see, I'd never taken a hook out of the fish's mouth. I caught a lot of fish, but Mom and Dad always did that dirty task for me. And so I panicked. I left the rod on the dock with the fish frantically flopping about and ran back to find my father. Fish stories. If you've ever fished, you have a fish story or two. And usually there's a tale about the one that got away. And perhaps the biggest fish story of all is found in the book of Jonah. That great fish that swallows Jonah. That might be the only thing you remember about that tale. And if you grew up in Sunday school, you probably learned that story from a Sunday school teacher using flannel graph characters to illustrate. I'm not sure flannel graph would work anymore in the digital age, but they did the job for a lot of us. Now, 19 summers ago, 2002, my first summer here, we held a community-wide vacation Bible school. Dozens and dozens of kids came from our church and other churches. There were 20 or so teachers who volunteered, and it was quite the sight. The campus was buzzing. Lots of excitement, lots of energy. And the program that year centered around the story of Jonah. It was called Jonah's 3-Day Adventure. It was all about the 3 days Jonah spent in the belly of the great fish. Now, it's not called a whale in the Bible. They didn't know that a whale was a mammal, just a big fish. But we always picture Jonah inside the belly of a big whale. Now, what made that year's program especially successful, a huge hit, was the giant whale the teachers designed, and it was impressive. It was enormous. It almost filled an entire classroom, as its giant mouth filled with big white teeth that served as the doorway into the belly of the fish. And kids would gather inside the belly of the whale and listen to the story. Then on day 3, when Jonah was vomited out of the fish's belly onto dry land, all of the kids would come running out, whooping and hollering with joy, and they loved it. Who wouldn't have? Now, sermons have different purposes. Some are meant to inspire, some to encourage and comfort. Others are intended to challenge. This sermon is a wonder sermon. Doesn't mean it's filled with awe and beauty or that it will be wonderful. But here's what I wonder and worry about, and I'd love to get your thoughts. But here's my wonder. Kids who typically come to Vacation Bible School or Sunday School are somewhere between the ages of 3 and 10 and 12. And kids that age take things literally. The world is still very black and white. The problem is, at least from my vantage point, just about the age children, youth, begin to think abstractly, they stop coming to church. At what age did your kids start giving you a hard time about coming to church? Oh, Mom, do I have to? None of my friends do. Now, that might not have been the case when I was growing up or some of you were growing up, some 40, 50, 60, 70 years ago, but it is today. So just about the time their brains can begin to think abstractly, they leave. And they rarely have the opportunity to understand some of our great stories as parables or metaphors, wonderful works of fiction that raise important questions, not literal stories, but playful, imaginative stories with a point to make. Stories that invite us not to believe, did Jonah spend 3 days in the belly of a fish, but about the stuff that matters, like what kind of people do we want to be? What's important to us and why? And where do we and others fit into the picture? Why are we here? And most of our children are never encouraged or taught to hear the stories that way, the way they might understand one of Aesop's fables. Then they go to high school, and it's not that the high school is filled with godless atheists. But there our children start learning about how the world really came into being, and the universe's story from the vantage point of the Hubble telescope. And that rings so true to them, whereas the story of Genesis, which was never meant to explain how, but why, suddenly seems irrelevant or pointless or trite. And for many of our children, they think the choice is between science and faith, science and the Bible. And if that's how the argument is framed, we are going to lose every single time. They never learn that the church is about a lot more than simply what we believe, but about how we live, about being in a community. There are other things many of us, not just kids, never learn, like the historical context behind these stories. Take Jonah, for example. It's written near the end of the Old Testament period, and there was a great debate raging throughout the nation, a great divide in the country, not unlike our country. Two other books were written about the same time Jonah was written, Ezra and Nehemiah. And their agenda was purity, to purge the nation of all the foreigners. Ezra went so far as to demand that if a man was married to a foreign woman, he needed to divorce her. Their agenda? Make Israel great again. Along comes Jonah. He takes a different stance. He writes a polemic piece of literature that insists that God can even love our enemies. Even those people who have harmed us are welcomed by God into the fold. All three books purport to be the Word of God. Now, unless God has a split personality disorder, they both can't be the Word of God. They both can't be true. So a thoughtful, informed reading of these stories leaves us with a question. Not what did God really say, but what kind of people, what kind of country, what kind of nation do we want to be? And that's a question many of us are thinking about right now. Of course, it's easy in a sermon to talk about loving the enemy. And so as I was working on the sermon to bring it home, I closed my eyes. And I pictured some people that I struggle to love, people I struggle to respect, people who can get my blood boiling. And the question I asked, can my heart be softened so that even if today I can't say I love that person, maybe I can be a little kinder, a little more respectful to that person, and maybe in time I can come to love him or her. Frank Schaeffer, in his wonderful little book called Why I Am an Atheist Who Still Believes in God, has an idea that I so appreciate. He says the message of Jesus boils down to this. Essentially, Jesus said, to heck with mere survival. Let us choose to evolve into a new and better animal. That's what I hope for myself and for all of us watching, that we might choose to evolve into better animals, people who are quicker to recognize the good in others, capable of giving and receiving love not just from members of our own little tribe, but the great tribe of humanity. And the place to start is right where we are, loving and caring for those who come our way. Even this day, amen.
star shines down upon you. May it be as darkness falls, your heart will be true. You walk a lonely road. Oh, how far you are from home.
Thank you, Cindy and Carolyn, AJ and May, Stacy and Joe and Scott, and thank you so much for watching. I'll leave you with a simple question. Where might my heart, where might your heart, our hardened hearts need some softening? Amen. Thank you.
forgot to do that yesterday. Thanks for reminding me.
You want to do that right now?
Did you already do it?
I wanted to make sure that Michael got it, but yes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm bringing back you some goodies.
Yeah,
I created. Well,
Nothing new.
Recycled.
To redo for next year.
That's right.
Okay.
Well, when it takes a long time, Michael.
I know. Actually, I do like getting those little red berries back. Sure.
And a little blue glass dish. That was much appreciated.
Oh.
Michael, did you get my face video?
Thank you.
Do you
have a special recipe for that soup you made?
Oh, which one did I get?
Well,
was it the